I would like to say about this wonderful speech that was given, if you did not understand everything that Lynn was speaking about today, I suggest that you sign up to become a part of Schiller Institute and attend some of the organization's programs that they have and the schools that they have, and you will be very much blessed. I asked the next speaker, what did he want me to say about him? And he said, use your own mind. It reminds me of the time my son was approximately 2 years old. And I had a way of playing with him. I'd take my finger and say, bite, and jerk my finger back. And once I forgot to move my finger, and he bit. And I said, oh, you bit me. He said, you told me to do it. So whatever I say, he told me to do it. Our next speaker was born in Mississippi. His father and mother gave him a wonderful foundation. It taught him to love, to respect, and to understand. And that he did not forget. When he was born, his mother looked at him and said, oh, he's so small, but he has such a big head. Told me to say. And his father said, that is an indication that he has a lot of brain, and I'm proud of him. And he has made us proud of him ever since. He had a way of being kind to people, regardless of who it might be. He would help elderly women across the street when he thought that they could not cross. He would help his young sisters and brothers. He would even help those that he didn't know. For example, he was on the playground and they were sliding up and down one of the sliding boards. And of course, in those days, the sliding boards had just plain wood. And the little boy, whom he didn't even know, was sliding down the board, and one of the splinters tore his pants. And the boy started crying. He said, why are you crying? He said, because my mother is going to whip me for tearing my pants. And he said, I've got a nickel in my pocket. I'll give it to you if you stop crying. And he gave the nickel to the little boy. He is still that type of fella who believes in giving and forgetting that he has given. Having been born in Mississippi, a place where people were told that because of the color of your skin, you cannot rise, his father and mother told him differently, that the sky is the limit. All you have to do is to work toward your aim in life, to hitch your wagon to a star and climb up the very top. And he has tried. And I can say that he has done very, very much to change the situation. He was told that we are going to try to break these shackles that African Americans are under. They cannot register. They cannot vote. They cannot have their civil rights like everybody else. Yet, they have to pay their taxes. In those days, his father had to work on the road to pay taxes. Yet, he could not vote, and he was not registered, and he could not take a part of the civil rights that every American is supposed to take. After he found out that he could not expand in Mississippi, he decided that he would travel. And he went somewhat north. He went to Canada. He went to Cincinnati. He went to Chicago. And during that time, he was just a young man. He found that Martin Luther King was determined with those around him to see that everybody was able to get their civil rights and to vote. Dr. King decided he was going to make him his lieutenant. So he called upon him. He found out that he had an unusual amount of wisdom and understanding about what was going on. So he told him that I want you to help to make the programs and the plans that I will have to abide by. And he did. And everybody thought he was so great that when they found out that he did not believe in segregation either way, then they figured that he has gone beyond what some of even the leaders of the African Americans did believe in. And that was when Dr. King was killed, everybody was upset. And they caught James Earl Ray. And immediately they were saying, just like the people said when Christ was about to be crucified, crucified James Earl Ray because he killed Dr. King. Kill him. Put him in the electric chair. And Reverend Bevel said, no. Let us give the man a fair trial. And because of his not believing that this man should be put in prison without a fair trial, a lot of his own people and my people felt that he was against what we stood for. But he realized, and it is true, that discrimination and segregation is like the sun in that it shines upon people regardless of color, creed, denomination, or servitude of birth. And to this day, we have found that James Earl Ray was just a pawn in the hands of those who are stronger than he was. And I introduced to you a man who is still fighting that James Earl Ray will have a fair trial, Reverend James Bevel.
Thank you, Sister Amelia Boynton, and to my good friend, the friend of mankind, Brother Lyndon, to Sister Helga, and to all of my associates and all of you who are here. I am happy to be here. This is a marvelous occasion to be here in America in 1994 to hear Lyndon LaRouche says with absolute authority that the Titanic is going to sink. Well, I don't get too disturbed about it because we was at the concert last night and McFerrin was over there intimidating people with his singing. You see, he have this great ability to intimidate people. He gets to singing and have you thinking you can't sing. But what was interesting, he was actually singing about, and I was saying to someone last night, I said, now they don't, people not listening to him. He was singing this thing about, give me Jesus. And I remember we used to sing that and people said, you guys are crazy. Here you walk around, the white folk got everything, and you just want Jesus. Well, now what Lyndon was talking about today when he talked about civilization in the last 600 years, he's talking about those communities and congregations of people, most of whom were European people, who grasped
and applied the principles of Christ to social living. And civilization advanced to the degree that the person or people adhere to those principles. And outside of that, there is no civilization. Now, a guy can say, well, I'm a Buddhist. It doesn't make any difference. You still got to be a Christian. If you're Buddhist, if you're Muslim, you still got to be a Christian if you're going to be rational and conscious. Because you got to deal with the truth of that discovery. Because this guy, Christ, discovered something. And we want to talk about that today. Now, when I was asked to speak on this thing of James Earl Ray and Dr. King, all this energy came up in me, and because I was there when King was killed, and this is a horrendous experience. But I went by to see Lyndon, and he have this marvelous ability to help you get rid of your rage. See? That's what a doctor is, a man who helps you get rid of your rage. And I want to talk about that because it's seriously significant. I was working on a song, and I want y'all to help me sing it. Just one verse, and we work on it later on tonight. And so everybody can sing. The only thing that don't sing is the buzzard. Everybody. All the birds sing but the buzzard. Now, this is a simple little song, and it's called, Which Side Are You On, Boy? Which Side Are You On? Which Side Are You On, Boy? Which Side Are You On? It's a very simple song. All right, now, here's the verse, so I want you to hear it. Lyndon LaRouche spent 5 long years in jail because he would not bow and scrape to the ADL. See? And then we go back in. Which side are you on, boy? Which side are you? See that? Which side are you on, boy? Which side are you on? They say Lyndon LaRouche spent 5 long years in jail because he would not bow and scrape to the ADL. Oh, which side are you on, boy? Which side are you? Everybody, which side are you on, boy? Which side? Now, let me tell you something. Now, a lot of people ain't singing. Now, the reason you are not singing, you have not yet decided which side you're on. See, you still over in that 101 economics. So I want everybody to sing. Like I told you, everybody can sing except the buzzard. Are we going to sing now? All right, let's go. Which side are you on, boy? Which side are everybody? Which side are you on, boy? Which side are you on? Lyndon LaRouche spent 5 long years in jail because he would not bow and scrape to the ADL. Oh, which side are you on? Everybody, which side are you on, boy? Which good, good. I just want to, now tonight we're going to work on creating some more verses on this song. You know, I was working on one verse that says the ADL had elected Negro congressmen to supervise their blacks, but they all lost their credibility because Farrakhan got the facts. So we're going to be working on that and building us some more verses on it and just have us a great song in terms of which side are you on. Now let me tell you what has always perplexed me. And this perplexity started when I started studying the life of Frederick Douglass. Frederick Douglass would speak to an audience, and he was so profound that people would just stand and just stomp and shout. And yet, when he finished, everybody went back and did what they did the day before. So it was like I was saying, now, did they hear what he said? How can you go and listen to a speaker who is telling the truth, and you know it's the truth, and you soon know a responsibility for what he said. And that had perplexed me for a long time. And I was out talking to Lyndon the other day, and he solved that problem for me. And that's what I want to talk about. Because if he comes and say, brothers and sisters, our economy, I have studied the ins and outs of it, and I have no reason to kid you. It is gone. Now, any reasonable person would say, wait a minute, but what are we going to replace it with? Because I don't intend to drown. See? If what you say is true, and it is true, then who is going to create the alternative? See? And we have to deal with that. Who is going to create the alternative? See? Now, if we don't create the alternative, Lyndon might come out about like Noah. Noah went around preaching and couldn't get the seven folks, Lyndon, to help him build a boat. Just about everybody drowned but him and these eight people. It's happened. Now, Jonah had a different experience. I don't know who was working with him, but when he got to Nineveh, he got all the people to agree. And he saved the whole town. And what I am saying is that I think we ought to opt for a Jonah experience rather than a Noah experience. I don't think we ought to agree or to let the people die. I think that we ought to agree to give ourselves to develop that alternative. And I said to Dr. Mark, the last meeting he was at, he was ranting and raving about how trifling people were. And I asked him a question. Can there be a freedom fight without freedom fighters? If there's going to be a freedom fight, first of all, you got to have some freedom fighters. If something is going to be done, there has to be somebody who is going to do the doing. And so, as Americans, then we have that responsibility. What I want to talk about is a motion made and a motion denied. Subtitle is, why do the American people, the American government, organizations, and institutions deny James Earl Ray his liberty and deny Martin Luther King his philosophical life? Why we do that? And this is a perplexing problem. It was until I was listening to Lyndon. He helped me solve this problem. I was mad about it. Mad with black people. See? Why do we not understand that the liberty of James Earl Ray is our common constitutional interest and responsibility? How is it that you can't see that? But let's don't stop at black folk. Let's talk about the American people. Why is it that the American people cannot see that James Earl Ray's liberty is your common constitutional interest and responsibility, and that if you do not uphold this responsibility and address this interest, you will lose your nation? Why can't you see that? And then why would you assume that, and don't play with me, and I got a son here, you can play with him, you know, talk crazy around, don't talk crazy around me, because I know, and you know I know, that a constitutional interest takes priority over every personal interest. Because every personal interest can be addressed within the context of addressing the constitutional issue. You know I know that, and you know you know that. So don't play crazy with me. So the question becomes, why is it that we, the American people, allow this man to be denied his liberty and claim we're responsible people? And I'm talking to everybody in here who's over 18, because you have a responsibility. And I know you still know, I mean what I say. I mean exactly what I say. Why aren't you down working on that? Why haven't you closed shop? And I look at Unifield, I look at Goodloe, they claim they're lawyers. Why haven't you set up shop full time to deal with this question? I look at these guys, Berkeley who claim he's a preacher and all that stuff.
Why haven't your church voted to go and work on that? I look at ICLC. Why haven't you closed debate on that and acted on that? I say to the Schiller Institute, why haven't you closed debate on that question that this man's liberty is our constitutional interest and responsibility? And do you presuppose that not accepting that responsibility that you could possibly carry on an intelligent discussion in America or in the world? Because everybody look at you and know you're a fool.
You're going to claim that you love Martin Luther King and James Earl Ray sits in jail for 25 years.
Which totally denies
the reason King even came to the country.
He didn't preach but two things. Don't judge a man by the color of his skin, but by the content of his character. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. He didn't preach but two things.
And he died. And we hadn't learned either one of the lessons.
That's tragic.
So I said, well, what's wrong with these people? What's wrong with these?
And so Lyndon, I was out to his house. I didn't even raise this question. He was just talking about something else. But he helped me to solve that problem.
What I want to do, I want to take you through some steps in history just to show you the science of government. Now, the guy who taught the science of government was Jesus Christ. He's the man. Now, I know a lot of folk had ideas and representations and almost governments. The guy that really came and taught the science of government, his first lesson plan in the science, he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God. His first move in learning government. Because you got to have something to measure something with, right? So he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Then he got into the operation of how government goes. And this is what he set up as the standard for the mind to operate as a government agent. You have heard that it was said to the men of old, you shall not kill, and whoever kills shall be liable to the judgment. But I say to you, do not be angry. Do not insult people, and do not call people a fool. That's the standard. Now, when I, as a young theological student, decided to practice that, I didn't know that that was government. I had read Tolstoy and I'd read Gandhi, and they said, well, if you live like this, you can just change things. I said, well, I don't think they were dealing with these white folk down in Mississippi and Alabama. I said, I don't see how that'll work down there. You know, I said, Tolstoy didn't know nothing about these people. And I don't think the British people could be as atrocious as them folk down in the Delta. I said, I don't. But anyway, since Christ taught it, let's go test it. Let's go test it. And we started a whole process of testing that theory. Now I'm going to take you through the first step, and I'm going to show you how this system works. Let me have my slide. This is the origin of the Civil Rights Movement by Morris. Go to our next slide. Now let's talk about emotion, how emotions are made, because most of us never think in terms of actually making motions. This is how motions are made. Here we are at a church. A decision to sit in the local churches was reached after much debate. The adults, mostly members of the ICLC, met with the students at movement headquarters and tried to persuade them to postpone the demonstration for a couple of days until money could be raised. According to Smith, the ICLC had $87. The NCLC told the students that money could be collected through the churches within a week. Then, according to Smith, James Bevel, a student at the American Baptist, said, I'm sick and tired of waiting, which was a strange thing to come from a kid who was only about 19. You see, the rest of us were older. Bevel said, if you asked us to wait until next week, then next week something would come up and you'd say, wait until the next week and maybe we'd never get our freedom. He said this, I believe that something will happen in the situation that will make for the solution to some of the problems we're talking about, so we decided to go on. Okay, now here you have a motion having been made within the social context of a people And you can see that that motion was second. The motion was second. We decided to go forward and do that. Now, those people could see that, yes, eating in the restaurant is our interest. That's our interest. Had nothing to do with this thing about black and white, because my understanding of restaurants is to serve hungry people. It has nothing to do with colored people. It has to do with hungry people. Yeah? So, you know? Now, they could understand that. So we made a motion. Now, let me explain to you how this works. Because most of us, even those of us who are in the institution and in the organization, and those of us support it, never think of ourselves as primary actors. We think that intelligent idea is supposed to come from LaRouche or somebody, or Helga or somebody. But it never occurs to us that rational thinking has within it power. Now let me show you how you approach a problem. Whether it's an individual problem, an organizational problem, or a social problem, you start the process of confessing and repenting and correcting and forgiving and making a motion in the interest of the whole. And you just keep that process going. And you just keep that process going. And you just keep that process going. And what happens is that every time you come up with a decision, your decision, once you confess and repent, which means you ain't trying to hide nothing, or you forgive people, that means you ain't ill-motivated to try to get even or compete with people, then your mind can squarely make a decision in the interest of the other person to the same degree that you make the decision in your own interest. That's what government is about. That if I am created in the image and likeness of God, and Lynn is created in the image and likeness of God, at what point should I should make a decision that does not take into account these two realities? And that Lynn didn't make himself, God made him, and God made me, and it is God who says, now you must respect people, independent of what they do or don't do. Okay, so government is that science by which you work for the health, interests, rights, and needs of people, whether they do it or not. That's what makes history. That's the power. Now, the point is, can't nobody stop you from doing that? Nobody can stop you from doing that. And if you make decisions on that basis, your local organization or your whatever group will be the most powerful and potent group in the environment. Nobody can stop you from doing that. I didn't know that. So we did a sit-in movement. Let's move to the next one. Let's show you. Give him that bus burning. The next year, I was getting ready to graduate. This has come from a book down to now. And we got this. We was graduating. Give me the picture. The picture. No. The one that Jamisa got there. We was... Mother's Day, 1963, Greyhound bus burn. I was graduating. We met, and the problem was CORE, Congress of Racial Equality, who had initiated this freedom ride, decided that, well, we must stop because they're burning the buses and they're killing the people, and we must stop because it's too dangerous. So it's obvious that if we're going to ride the buses and the people are going to do that, we should stop this. Give me the script on that. So we met. Tuesday we met. Bevel by that time became the chairman of the local group in Nashville. It was his job to appoint the people to continue riding. Nashville is supposed to be so democratic where people try to reach a consensus on everything and sort of wait and carry for a decision. I don't know why, but somehow so many people wanted to go that Bevel had to make the decision to appoint 10 people to continue the riding. So we appointed 10 people. Motion made. Motion second. That's reasonable. People could understand that. See? The question comes up, do you assume that I made that decision because I'm black? No, because around the country, there were thousands of black young men who chaired black organizations, but they didn't go on the freedom ride. So you have to ask, well, what is going on in this guy that is not going on in the other guys? Why did I see that as my constitutional interest and responsibility? That's what you got to ask. Why did I see that? What had happened to me in my development, in my conceptualization of life, and my conception of myself and my responsibility to the environment, why did I assume that I should leave school, leave my graduation, and go and deal with this question? It's not because I'm courageous. I'm one of the most cowardly people I know. So it couldn't be that. But the whole question of my constitutional interest and responsibility. See? So the motion was made. The motion was carried. And of course, by that Christmas, Kennedy had eradicated, passed the law to eradicate segregation on buses. So a motion was made, and a motion was carried. Let's move into the next. The Mississippi Project. The Mississippi Project. We were, black people couldn't vote, weren't allowed to register. They tried to register, they would get killed. Go to the next script. Also in Nashville, though not attending the workshops, were people who would go join SNCC, but whose interest lay in continuing direct action. Nash and Bevel, who later married Bernard Lafayette, Lester McKinney. Bevel and Lafayette had just returned from Jackson, where they were trying with a little success to get Mississippi students to test the facilities. And Bevel felt convinced that of the need to build a movement in his home state and wanted to go back there. And I fully agreed and planned to do the same someday myself. Now, there's a guy, Jim Foreman, who wrote that. And it's interesting, he was often getting angry, and he never did know that his anger was anchored in the fact that he always planned to do something someday. You understand what I'm saying? See, a lot of times people don't understand what caused them to be angry. The not willingness to assume your constitutional responsibility is that which causes you to be angry. Most folks don't even know that. They'll come and say, well, man, this guy made me mad. No. You get angry because you refuse to assume your constitutional responsibility, which you vote your own impotency because you don't assume that responsibility, see? Because once you assume that responsibility, you start seeing other options and opportunities. But you can't see those options and opportunities until after you assume that responsibility. That if the people can't vote in Mississippi and Alabama, is it not my constitutional interest to help these people to get the right to vote? I remember when I first was working on this, I went up to Skokie, Illinois, and was talking to a group of yuppie Jewish women. And they says, oh, sis, tell me, you beautiful people, how can we help you? So I just pulled out the stats and started going down the committee chairmanships in the Senate and in the Congress. And all of the significant chairmanships and all of the significant committees was controlled by the Dixiecrats. I said, do you see? By the South having a one-party system where we are disenfranchised at the ballot box, that disenfranchisement at the ballot box of us disenfranchise you at the committee chairmanship in Washington. Do you understand that when you do not address the constitutional interest of the people, that inadvertently you are in some way not addressing your own constitutional interest? See, when Martin Luther King said that, you might say, oh, Martin can rap. No, that's true. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. That's not a theory, that's fact. That's a fact. That's a fact. So it's not a question of being cute and helping somebody. When do you have the courage and the intelligence to say, no, no, I am going to assume this responsibility. I'm going to address constitutional interest. It is my God duty. God has put me here to do that. And that has to be priority. Let's go on through these. Let's get to the why we can't wait, going to the Alabama project. You got that one? It's out of King's book, Why We Can't Wait. So we made a motion. Miss Fannie Lou Hamer came forth and second that motion. Let me just read something from Miss Fannie Lou Hamer before going to that. And I read it. At the meeting, Amsa Moore, James Foreman, Reginald Robinson, Bob Moses, and Bevel spoke, preaching from the Bible, the 12th chapter of Luke, the 24th verse. Bevel talked about how a man could look out and see a cloud and predict that it was going to rain and it would come, but still he couldn't tell what was happening around about him. That made sense to Ms. Hamer, and after the other people spoke about voting, voter registration, and asked who would go on Friday to register, Mrs. Hamer held up her hand. So she seconded that motion. She seconded that motion. And of course, you know the rest of it, the Summer Project, the challenge to the Democratic Party, because a motion was put on the floor, and a motion was made, and a motion was seconded. And anytime you put a legitimate motion on the floor, a constitutional motion on the floor, within the context of a movement, and that motion is seconded and discussed and carried out in the spirit of that motion to attain justice, that's the power you have. And what I'm saying to a lot of us, we really never knew what actually was going on in the movement. We think it was some great mad. No. It's people sitting honestly discussing what constitute our interests, our constitutional interests, and deciding that the constitutional interest must take priority over the particular personal things. For instance, is it more important for Jim Bevel to see to it that people are voting, even though he may lose his life, than to be caught up worrying about his anniversary on a Cadillac car? I mean, this, you know. And when you go up on people, they come up with all these little trivial things. Well, I'm doing this. And yet, the significant things go unaddressed. Let's move to another one, the Martin Luther King book. In Birmingham, the movement all bogged down. Isn't it reasonable that a man should go into a community where his children are being brainwashed and teach them to be responsible? And say you can learn more sociology down in the jail than you can in the classroom. So let's go to jail. Let's fill up the jail. In other words, you know, the interesting thing, and you can find this in Coffin's book, Once to Every Man in Nation. The particular thing I taught the children in Birmingham that no other person would tell young people was this. You accuse white folks of oppressing black folks. That's not true. Your mom and dad and granddad was irresponsible. Now, if you start being responsible right now and don't relinquish that responsibility, you have the power to end segregation. And these little kids said, are you a kid? I said, I'm serious. And that little fella, 6 years old, 10, 12. I said, it doesn't make any difference about the age of a man when he makes a decision based on immortality and maintain it because it produces constitutionality. Wherein whoever is immoral, their decision's gonna end up with criminality. And this is the problem with us here today. We are a bunch of immoral criminals. Y'all understand that, right? The decisions we make are not based on immortality, so it produces no constitutionality. We have complaints about criminals, but we don't have an alternative to the criminality. We are arguing about OBE, but if I say, wait a minute, let's work out a curriculum that's totally scientifically correct based on Lyndon LaRouche's conception about what education is, and if I ask some of you guys, so wait a minute, let's don't go home since what he said is true. Let's stay here and join and work on and create an education committee and get out and teach it to the young folks and fight about it. You say, well, I got to go home and feed my cow. See, I mean, to me, it's that serious. If this man comes and says, now, this is what education is. Well, he can't sit up and work out all of the intrinsic theories and do the research on that. Somebody has to say he's right. So we'll join your committee on that and we'll work full time on the education question. And not only develop the curriculum and teach it to the mamas and the daddies and the kids, we will close down the schools about it just like they did about the right to eat or vote or something like that. If people don't come forth to do that, that will not get done. And we'll just be complaining about the kids being brainwashed. But we don't see how that is our constitutional interest and responsibility so that children go uneducated. And we just sit, assuming that the Board of Education or someone else is supposed to do that. No! The individual who can conceptualize that that is our constitutional interest and take responsibility for it have the power to bring about that change. Now let's move on then to the Voice of Freedom. Out of that book, Then we have a statement by Diane Nash, my former husband, and I, Jim Bevel, cried when we heard the bombing, because in many ways we felt that our children had been killed. We knew the activities of the civil rights movement had been involved in generating a kind of energy that brought out this kind of hostility. We decided that we would do something about it, and we said that we had two options. First, we felt confident that if we tried, we could find out who had done it, and we could make sure that they got killed. We considered that as a real option. The second option was that we felt that the blacks in Alabama, if they had the right to vote, they could protect the children. We deliberately made a choice, and we chose the second option. It's a motion and a second. And so, you know, the rest is history. We wound up in Selma and fighting for the right to vote. And it's interesting how this motion was finally second. Look at the second to this motion. This is very interesting how this motion got second. The motion was finally second on March the 15th, 1965. Mr. Speaker, members of Congress, I speak tonight for the dignity of man, the destiny of democracy. I urge every member of both parties, Americans of all colors in every section of this country, to join with us. And he goes on. For the cries and the pain and hymns and protests of an oppressed people have summoned into convocation all the majesty of this great nation, of the greatest nation on earth. Our mission is at once the oldest and the most basic of this country, to right wrong, to do justice, to serve man. Johnson seconded the motion on that. See? Now, what am I saying? So we put all these motions on the floor. And then we went to Chicago and we put the motions on the floor. And all these motions were seconded. All these motions were seconded. And then, we got to Memphis. Yeah, to Memphis. We got to Memphis. And King was killed. See? King was killed. And in the same spirit, King was killed. There he is, lying there on the back, and I am facing the police. King was killed. Motion was put on the floor. Ralph Abernathy was the new chairman. But everybody in here, basically, who was an adult, was in the meeting anyway. I move that the man who is accused of killing King be given a fair and impartial trial. That is my and everybody's constitutional interest. So I made that motion. And immediately Ralph Abernathy withdrew his second to that motion. I further made another motion that we should, in fact, put murder on trial and insist that nations stop killing people and teach the science of government to their young people. Because our security is not dependent on us knowing how to kill each other's kids and coming up with all these nuclear missiles and stuff and threatening each other. That's not the way human beings should live. And then I said, then we should organize and fight for education. That motion decisively died. And the tragedy is that motion has not yet been seconded by organizations in this country. Now, let me just say something to the people in the Schiller Institute, if you understand history. Do you understand your having not address the problem of Ray getting a fair trial is related directly to Lyndon LaRouche having to spend 5 years in jail? See? Do you understand that the jails being packed with kids is directly related to this man not having a fair trial? Do you understand that this man not having a fair trial has created three phenomena in our judicial system? Case law, plea bargaining, and capital punishment, of which none have anything to do with due process of law, where you find out the cause of a problem so you can institutionally and constitutionally address that problem, that the judicial system does not function at all. And the most classical case of its not functioning is Lyndon LaRouche's case, where there is compounded criminality in the court system. Because we didn't stand, and we didn't stand and have not stood. So no, let's get this guy his day in court. So the motion was made, and the motion was denied. And that's the tragedy in America today. The children in the streets, jails packed with people, the violence. And in denying this motion, one of the speakers said, and too many black people want blood too. See? Too many black people want blood. And so we're not going to stand and prosecute this because the black mob don't want to hear this. It's not popular to take that position. But if you do not stand for that which is right, then from whence do you suppose right comes? If you do not stand for what is just, how do you think justice will come about? It only comes about when we take a position and don't back down. So I've been in pain 20-some years. Have to walk around, American in jail. So a lot of y'all, so oh yes, we worked hard to get Lyndon LaRouche out. It's easy to love Lyndon LaRouche. He's an intelligent man, worked for everybody's interest. Wise man, best economist in the world. But what about this guy, Ray? He's poor white trash. He's a nobody. But did not Jesus say that when you do it to the least of these? So you don't get no credit for getting him out of jail. No, no, no. See, I studied the records in heaven. You don't get no credit for getting Lyndon out of jail. You get nothing for that. No, you don't get nothing. What about this poor white trash who have no family, who have not an intelligent, audacious wife? What about this man who is inarticulate and who was robbed of his education just like poor black people? What about this man? What about this man? And do you presuppose that you're going to go up to heaven? And I believe in the judgment. I believe in bugles and trumpets and things. I believe in all that stuff. You presuppose that you're going to walk up and knock on heaven's door and says, well, I'm here now. And the Creator gonna say, now, did you come from America? And so I don't have no place in my records here where you worked for justice for the least of these. And you said, well, I was busy. I was doing things. I was running a campaign. I was raising money. I was getting my degree. I was sending my kids to school. I was doing all of these things. And that's the tragedy in America today. And that's why we don't understand his economics. We don't even understand what this man talking about. Because let me explain something to you so you'll understand this economics. If you do not address your constitutional interests and responsibility as a priority, your mind cannot even think scientific economics. You think financial schemes. See, you don't understand where the financial schemes come from. The financial schemes come from the minds of people who do not discuss and work through the constitutional interest as a priority. They come up then with these financial schemes, and they come up with this slavery and job training. A man who thinks in terms of his constitutional interest, he thinks in terms of scientific economics, scientific development, and education. I mean, it's like two different worlds. The problem with most of you is that you have your feet in one world and your head in another. You said to Lyndon LaRouche, yeah, you smart, you right. But then you go back and get involved in these financial schemes and in the slavery and job training games. You won't come out and say, hey, man, we will stand with you and we will transform our nation. You gonna say a man is intelligent and right, and then you don't care about what he's talking about? That's what I try to tell guys with Martin Luther King. They said, well, why you work? I said, what he says is right. How can I go and preach and shout Negroes and tap church benches when this man said what you have to do is go and organize people and educate people, and you must face evil with your very life? And you think I was gonna say, well, that's a good speech, King. However, my Cadillac bill got to be paid. And you know, the great tragedy, you go around and you see black guys my age, Linda, and every one of them was a personal friend of Martin's. Yeah, Martin and I. And when this man was here saying, let's do this, and let's work on this, and let's work on this, and this is right, They turn their back on their constitutional interests. Now, let me tell you who this guy is. So a lot of people, when I came around, they said, well, how could Bevel know who LaRouche is? We've been around him 20 years. This Negro been plowing mules over in a tomato field. How are he going to know who Lyndon LaRouche is? Give me that last seed, no, the other one. Let me tell you what I got so tickled when I read this. You see that? We was hiding out in the ghetto doing that, and we wouldn't let Bush and them know what we was doing because we was confident if they did, they'd kill us. Because now, when you get into Lyndon's thermodynamics of economics, that's exactly what we worked out. Now, let me tell you how we came by this. Brooks and Dr. Mark, we all started on this together, plowing mules. Because we decided, okay, we ain't gonna beg and we ain't gonna steal and we ain't gonna get hung up in grants. How do you make this thing work? How do you build an economy where you don't compromise yourself and don't violate nobody? See, if you don't answer that question, you're not a Christian. You're not an American. You assume that you got to be a criminal or a thief or a beggar. So we started working on this thing. Now, if you put a bank over there under that eight that we call it a man, as these institutions work, the church, the government, the business, the clinic, and then you got food, farming, clothes, making, housing. As you do work in all of these institutions, they all generate resources of which you put in the bank, and then you all your money is put back in these institutions, which causes an expansion, which Lyndon described as thermodynamics of economics. So when I read his theory on economics is a study of the principles and means by which a people is able to produce the material precondition for its own continued existence. Let me tell you the strategy that you're in, you guys who got light skin and thank you white people. Tell you the strategy you're in. What you don't understand is that the British people have decided that everybody in America are niggas. That's what you don't understand. See? In other words, the reason America was set up doesn't even exist for that reason anymore. It was set up so you could have an economy based on the family, based on the integrity of the person, the sacredness of family life, marriage, and out of that, in his economics, he defined the family as a primary unit. We have decided that there should not be family, that homosexuality is right, and that you just need to be slaves. And all of you people basically bought into that. And when I say you bought into it, when this guy come and say, this is what economics is, I know that that's my constitutional interest and responsibility. Now, I was over in Chicago. This great big old burly black guy came up to me and said, Bevel, we think something's wrong with you. I said, more than likely it is. He said, tell me. He says, now, why are you with this Lyndon LaRouche? I said, well, you know, I can understand some of your fears and problems. I said, because white people are strange people. I said, now, generally, they claim their God gives them more authority than our God gives us. For instance, they generally claim they have a right to go around disrespecting people. They don't have no problem with it. You know, boy Clinton, he's on the campaign trail, left the campaign trail to go home to kill a man. He just thinks that's his right. Or at the convention, he wouldn't even let the issue of capital punishment be discussed. Just think he have the right to this. Then he takes over the army and says, well, now the men can have sex with each other. I said, see how this white man claimed that his God give him authority that our God don't give us? I said, now Lyndon LaRouche don't claim God give him these authorities. I said, so I work with him because he don't make these claims. Now, why are you working with Clinton? See, why would you not work with a man who is constitutional and make moves all the time in the constitutional interest of all humanity? Why would you not make be in a relationship with a man like that, working with that man to carry out the work that has to be carried out in the good of all humanity? Why would you not? And we talk about, must Jesus bear the cross alone? No. Must Lyndon LaRouche bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No. There's a cross for everyone. Do you think I'm going to show up in heaven and tell God that Lyndon LaRouche did more work in the
interests of people than I did, I'd be a fool. I don't play about that. If he is going to work 168 hours a week for the interests of the American people and to save the people, because he said the economy system is done, that's true, but to build a new economy based on this principle, on this definition that he gives, I know that if this is going to be done, somebody has to work on this all the time. People don't just drink beer because they like beer. Budweiser be putting this stuff out in advertising all the time. Their trucks are running. Their billboards are up. They're pampering folks' minds to get them to be drunk all the time. And if criminals can work to get people involved in criminality, then how are we not going to work to get people involved in the sciences that would free them in the nation? This is serious. This is serious. Now, just let me just tell you something we need practically. We need now. Dentists need 12 people. New people. They said, no, we work on education. See? We need 12 people to say, well, we will work on any area to get James Earl Ray his fair trial. We need 12 people. Come work on that. Go to work on that. Whole new area, they ain't even covered. Base ain't even covered. We have to put in precinct councils. And Poppy said, why you got to have a precinct council? I'm tell you why. Because if you're going to fight for education, you got to have a community stabilized and conscious enough to fight that fight. Because when you hit, you always get hit. And you got to have a process by which you process and fire back. Or, for instance, we have to get the Federal Reserve put on the Congress. That has to be done. Gonzalez can't do that by himself. There has to be a team working full time to get that done. Washington has to be organized. You got to have a team of people working full time doing that. The American people have to have the principles of the Declaration of Independence put back into their hearts and in their mind. People have to work on that full time.
And I look at people, and we come to conferences, and we say, Lyndon, keep on going. And we go back home. Why does he do this? Now, this is what we get into. I show you how he saved me from being mad with people. He said, now, you see, in education, the child has to re-experience this great creative idea. And I said, oh, I see what's wrong with the people. I see. God had this great idea to make man. And you know, most of y'all ain't experienced him with that. To go back through that experience. See, that's who Jesus was. Jesus Christ actually experienced God working with this idea of making man. That's what it means to get religion. To re-experience God creating man in his image and likeness. That's why you don't think constitutionally. Because you don't see yourself as having dominion over the earth. That's why you fall into the trap of being white and black and middle class and whatever that is. Or Presbyterian or Catholic. Because you have never experienced you and God working on this idea together of making man. You haven't experienced it. And that's why the constitutional issues don't go addressed, because the American people have not experienced the idea of God creating man. And then God breathed into man the breath of life, that creative act. And he says that you got to go back through that and be educated into that so that you experience that. So you say, well, every time Lyndon LaRouche gets up, he's talking about this divine spark in man. Why are you always talking about that and you don't always talk about it? Is that something he just made up, or is that something he experienced? Push him on and ask him. I'll tell you, it's something he experienced. Why do you think he always responds in terms of the constitutional interests of the people?
I was talking to some black people the other day, and they said, well, who are these LaRouche people? I said, well, I'll tell you something. I said, before any black folk, and they still ain't doing it yet, was dealing with this whole question of genocide of the third world, these folk was out on the limb about that. But they don't do it because they're white or black. That ain't the reason they speak on these things. They speak on these things because of the experience they have had with God creating man. See, a lot of times, you know, people don't talk about their religion. And you see them picking up logs, and you see them turning the world, and you say, well, where do they get that from? No, they don't get it because their hearts are smart. They get it because of what have happened to their hearts. They have lived through that. And I'm saying to you, you got to have that creative experience. That's Christian education is real. So you experience being made in the image and likeness of God. You experience God breathing into you the breath of life. You experience yourself as having dominion over the earth. And then you can say, no, James Earl Ray has to have a fair trial because of who I am. You don't know, the children must be educated because of who I am. No, we must have an economy that is based on truth and righteousness, based on who I am. Now, my brothers and sisters, do not make snide remarks about religion because pimps play with churches. Understand? Don't think marriage is cheap because homosexual and pimps play with sex. There's something sacred about marriage. There's something sacred about a relationship with God. Because until you have a relationship with God, you cannot have a proper relationship with one another. When I told somebody, Nina came up to me, tell me about Lyndon LaRouche, he's in jail. I said, let me go see this guy. See, I said, I'm looking for a man. See, because when I'd worked this out, the way I got to this, I had fought a war in myself about lust. See, the first I had to deal with loving people, loving white guys. So they beat me up and I still forgive them. Then I had to deal with, well, I got to have a relationship with black women to the same quality degree that I have with white guys. So my relationship with black women was not based on me being afraid of them or hating them like I did white guys, lusting and playing with them. So I had to solve that problem. So when I solved that problem, I understood economics. I said, now if this guy couldn't write this, if he hadn't solved that problem. See, because a man who's a pimp can't write this. No, Playboy won't write this. So I went out there to see him in London. He tickles me because he's like a musician. He just goes through history and science and he get this big instrument, you know. And just, he's sitting up in prison. I sat there with him all day once. He's just making music with history and science. And I said, now this guy just might be slick. I said, I tell you what I do. I'm going and meet his wife. I said, because most white guys play like they're married, but they really got prostitutes who play like they're his wife. I said, I'm going and see. I said, now if she can think, then he's married. So I said, well, I need to go see Mrs. LaRouche. And when I met her, it was a delight. Because it reminded me, talking with her, of talking with King, that I would ask crazy questions. She'd get the craziness out and give her the intelligent answer back. So then I got tickled. I said, I know why Bush and him got this guy in jail, because he got a wife. I mean, really, men who don't have wives, they get mad with married guys. Because the energy going on that don't go in between unmarried people. You see? This economics comes out of that level of purity. See? Now let me just tell you something. I'm going to quit. And you got to understand this. And blacks need to get off of this trip. And don't you get on no hallelujah trip because you ain't black. Who was Martin Luther King? Historically. Martin Luther King was Samson. Y'all know about Samson, right? The Nazarite. Whipped the whole army with the jawbone of an ass, tore up the gates of the city. Oh, Samson's a strong man. But he had an area of himself that he hadn't addressed, which was this whole question of the law by which you relate to females, and that tripped him up. See? Now, no intelligent Jewish scholar would leave that out of the Bible because it would insult Jews, because that's what happened. In fact, every boy needs to read the book so he'll know how to stay out of Delilah's house. That's good information. And I'm not embarrassed about that problem because it should be an example. But who is Lyndon LaRouche? Lyndon LaRouche is Joseph. That's who he is. And you need to understand that. Joseph went to jail, you remember? Because he wouldn't go to bed with a man's wife. But the Lord raised Joseph up and made Joseph the minister of economics and agriculture of Egypt. You remember that? Because of the purity of his heart and his ability to think inclusive. Now that's who. And stop doing what you're doing and go to work with this man. And watch your mind develop. And let me tell you something. You can play if you want to. You cannot learn the science that this man is talking about working for Bush or working for Budweiser. You can't do it. You have, and what Jesus talked about when he said, you can't serve two masters. You have to leave one and serve the other. You can't learn economics and constitutionality. You can't learn marriage, law, plan, boyfriend, girlfriend. You can't do it. You have to leave the foolishness alone and work full time with the wisdom. You have to do that. And what am I saying to you? All of you. And some of you say, well, Reverend, I'm too old to make them kind of adjustments. I'm saying to all of you, you ought to sell out and come to work. Because we got a nation to save. It's serious out here, serious in the world. And I'm getting tired of hearing bad news. Every time you pick up the newspaper, I just wonder sometimes I don't read the briefing because I get tired of bad news. But the only way we're going to have good news is that good people are going to be doing good things. And so I'm challenging all of you. Don't just come to the conference. We need everybody here. We need everybody in the working full time. I'm serious about that. So we can turn this nation and this world around. So God has given us a Joseph, who's given us the definition of economics. And we can take the principles learned from the 60s and accomplish the goals of economics that LaRouche talks about. And I'm challenging each of you here to become a full-time organizer. I mean literally what I'm talking about. When you look at our cities and when you look at the world, we can determine the outcome of history by what we do. And so I challenge you, my brothers and sisters, come and join the army. God bless you and God keep you.
We are going to have 45 minutes of questions and answers. This panel is too delightful to end, even though it's been going on for many hours, and I'm going to try everyone's patience, but I think it will be worth it. And while we begin that, I would like to, as we're beginning the question and answer period, I would like to invite up Dr. Najib Satrabi, who's the personal representative President of Bosnia Izetbegovic in Washington, D.C., and he has a few words that he would like to say to us.
Chairman, Mr. and Mrs. LaRouche, friends, in Bosnia it is cold, it is snowing. If I'm there, I will speak for a long time because the people will not wait for lunch. Being Bosnian, I am proud with dignity in sacrifice that my people show. I'm proud for the suffering and endurance that they did show in their sacrifice. There is reason. We in Bosnia live in peace for a long time. The ignorance and liars are telling that we hate each other for a long time. If we did, one group of us will not exist. In Sarajevo, we do have Muslims, Serbs, Croats, Jews, and others. In Bosnian army, as they call a Muslims army, we have Serbs and Croats, generals and fighters. We are fighting not for Muslims' cause, but we are fighting for the cause of the people of Bosnia. They are asking, tell us what you want. Tell us what is your bottom line. Our bottom line is to live together in peace, with dignity, with love and understanding and respect for each other. We didn't start this war. They call this war civil war now. They would like to inform people. Sometimes we know that informations are lies. Ethnic cleansing is not a journalistic description what is going in Bosnia. It is program of Serbian aggression. This is their concept, what they want. They would like to have so-called pure Serbian land. And when I'm telling these things, I very much appreciate Serbs fighting in Bosnian's army against pure Serbian land. When the world starts to speak about ethnic cleansing, Radovan Karadžić tried to correct himself and he said, no ethnic cleansing, but ethnic shifting. Yes, I address you as friends because you invite me to come to say a few words to you. You raise your voice in favor of Bosnia. You wrote about us. And it is the reason why I'm happy being here. And let me add a few words more. We don't want dominance of any group. Bosnia was multi-ethnic, multicultural, multi-religious society of equal men and women. We live together in the peace. When Berlin Wall was broken, we expect that we will have freedom, that communist tyranny was over. Unfortunately, that father of Zhirinovsky, Slobodan Milosevic, had his own program. I call him father of Zhirinovsky because without tolerance for Milosevic, we will not have Zhirinovsky. We have free elections, and with elections we have in our presidency two Muslims, two Serbs, two Croats, and one who consider himself Yugoslav. We still do have same composition of our presidency. We don't want that any group will dominate or will be dominated. We want to share responsibility. For us, to defeat one group, it means call for revenge. We don't want victory. We want peace and understanding. But we want punishment for war criminals. No punishment that will be imposed on them by us, but will be imposed on them by international community, because we want to have justice, no revenge. And we want this justice, no just that we will see people punished, but at the same time, when guilty will be punished, innocent will be exonerated. And it is the reason why in our program we are calling. Our program is peace, and give us arms to fight, not to defeat, but to create balance of power, that killing of victim of aggression will be expensive, and having such balance, we will have the peace. Second thing is what we want International Tribunal for War Crimes. We will appreciate if the West will have will and moral strength to intervene by airstrikes. Unfortunately, our hopes are on the bottom. But our desire to exist is stronger than anything else. They are asking us, you want peace, sign it. We want peace, but we don't want surrender. Because the peace without justice, without fairness to anyone, is not peace, but postponement of fighting. In Bosnia, we have so-called blue berets, UNPROFOR. They told us they are not there to be peacemaker, they are peace keeper. We know they are neither, no peacemaker, no peacekeeper, but they are fighting observer. They are telling us, they guarantee that humanitarian aid will come, that you will survive, you will have food and maybe a little bit heat. But 50% more food is given to the Serbs, 330% more food is given Croats than Muslims. And it is not statistics of Bosnian government, it is statistics of UNPROFOR. Yes, we need your voice. I believe we have your heart, and we would like to have your reason. And we will have your reason if you know a little bit more about us. We are not trying to have war. We want peace. We are not trying to defeat anyone, but stop fighting. We are not trying to dominate anyone, but to share responsibility. It is our program, it is our goal, and it is the reason why we accept suffering. We did say, it is better to be killed than to be killer. But when it's question about the future of our nation, we have to resist. Because at least our name will survive. In this world, we know who is aggressor. We know who are victims of aggression. And there is another group, observers who are doing nothing. And these are guilty part too. Thank you very much.
People should line up at the mics and we'll start the question and answer period. Can identify themselves if they want to.
My name is Mark Calney. I'm the LaRouche Democratic candidate for governor of the state of California. I want to address two things. One is I've just returned recently from Scotland, and I wanted to convey, and I would be remiss not to, our friends there on the success of this conference and the release of Mr. LaRouche. And I might add that there is definitely a crisis in the United Kingdom, a moral crisis, to have a Labour Committee member to speak the universities in the United Kingdom and address the evils of David Hume, of Adam Smith, of Bentham, and be paid for it represents a tremendous potential. The second thing I want to talk about is earthquakes. And from Los Angeles, we had this earthquake, as people know, about a month ago. And it indicates one problem, and that is that God needs help. We need to help God, because the earthquake was not centered appropriately, and it missed Hollywood. It knocked out some of the porno industry for a while, but they're still running. So as part of the campaign that I and Ted Andromedis and Dave Kilber and the other candidates are running is to go after and attack Hollywood. And we want to do that in a manner that we go into the inner cities and address the issue of violence. It's not just the gangs, it's the drugs, it's the violence of the destruction of the human mind that the institution of Hollywood represents. And it's something we should have been doing more aggressively. We started to do it around the AIDS campaign, but this is a perfect target. There we have an overlap of the ADL, organized crime, the porno industry, the so-called entertainment industry, the brainwashing that is going on. And if you can't knock out the ADL in Hollywood, it's like shooting fish in a barrel, and the fish are on the surface and they stink. And this is, we have an opportunity. I would like to invite and take up and second Reverend Bevel's motion on the question of Ray and use this as a means of going in there to show them not just the evil and the racism of what Hollywood represents, but real culture. We need to bring Sheila's play out there. We need to bring McFerrin out there as part of a series of conferences to address these issues and intervene against Hollywood and go after the ADL and shut them down. Thank you.
Next.
Yeah, I'd just like to ask Mr. LaRouche, how would you deal with the war in Bosnia?
Well, last year, the spring, it could have been dealt with in a more straightforward form. But today, it's more difficult because what has been done, what's been done to Russia, Ukraine, and other parts of Eastern Europe, have created a interlocking strategic
problem which has to be addressed as such. It has to be, you cannot do anything unless you state clearly what you're doing. You can't go in and simply bomb and not expect to have complications which are unwanted, which might prevent you from accomplishing what your objective is in the first place. The British, as Helga mentioned, wanted bombed, want the bombing done now, which they opposed last year, is a way of trying to impose a partition of Bosnia. So a simple act of saying do this and do that doesn't work. What you have to do at this point is to name the game. In the history of mankind, there are only two views of man. One is a view of man as imago Dei, in Latin, as man in the image of God, and therefore you must have a society which develops and fosters the potentialities of the individual in that way, which means fostering the family and protecting the family to that purpose. The other is a view of usury, a view of treating the majority of mankind as cattle and exploiting them. This was infamous in the worshippers of Baal and Moloch used to do this. The worshippers of the cult of Delphi did this. Venice did this. And the British Empire, you know, it's like a bunch of Hollywood body snatchers went up to Britain at the end of the 16th century, and they took the British people, and they took their souls out, and they put Venetians in, Venetian demons. And they produced by this means, the majority of the British people were reduced to the state of cattle, and you had a few Brits who had these Venetian demons stuck in them, which practiced ancient crimes, and they became a privileged class of imitation Venetians, who practices ancient evil of insisting that the majority of mankind must be cattle. Now, the problem here is that when we, as we have done many times, not speaking just me and others, but I represent a tradition, when we said, let us use the great opportunity of the collapse of the wall to open up cooperation, to get a new principle of development of man on the basis of scientific and cultural progress, that image must be the basis upon which we rebuild Eurasia and the rest of the world. The British Venetians, well, not the British people, I suppose anybody who's been up there would know that. The British people are barely capable of human speech. They've been so ruined by what's done to them over the period from Wilson through Thatcher. Any government that will tolerate a major indicates the people aren't in such good shape. But this agency of the Anglo-Americans, typified by this Venetian bloodsucker sitting on the top of the British Isles, moved in as it moved in to create two world wars in this century, as it moved in to put Hitler into charge in Germany in order to ensure a war between Germany and Russia, has done the same thing again in the Balkans. If you do not say at this point that the problem is the repetition of this so-called geopolitical game of preventing the economic cooperation of Eurasia, because such cooperation would destroy the British Empire in the former times, or their objectives today, and that you start wars in the Balkans to involve the Russians with Serbia, is what they did in 1912, 1914 through the Pan-Slavs, to involve the French and the British in an Entente Cordiale, to suck Russia into war and to get Germany in the middle to prevent what Witte dreamed of, to have France, Germany, Russia, and other countries collaborating for the development of all Eurasia, to prevent that. You have to say that's what it is. You have to say that Thatcher said to do it, it's her policy, that Major continues it, that Carrington, who was Kissinger's friend, does it, that Kissinger's part of it, that Eagleburger did it as a criminal, Berent Scowcroft, the advisor of Bush, did it, that Bush was complicit. When you tell the truth, and now say, we are going to act not simply to deal with Bosnia. We have to act to end this way of doing things. We have to eliminate this Venetian factor. We have to eliminate the continuing cause of two world wars and the threat of a third. We're not going to be actors playing games in a British game. What we're going to do is we're going in the gaming hall. We're going to take the tables. We're going to throw them out. We're going to put the gambling masses in jail. And we're going to have a meeting. And we're going to end this game. We're going to go back to being human. On that basis, then you can do something. But the problem is now, whereas a year ago, you could have done something fairly straightforward and simple as a military act, which would have changed the situation, if you'd had the guts to break the British. If you don't break the British today, or attack them and expose them as being the criminals behind this, not the poor Serbs, but the British government, the British Foreign Office, they did it. Karadzic is an agent of Lord Owen, and has been an agent of Lord Owen. That group that ran this operation were agents of the British for years. I know it. I know it from the inside. If you don't name that game, then everything you do is going to backfire. You're just throwing a match into a room full of gasoline fumes. You've got to say, the British did it. We're going to hold the British to account in the sense that we are going to end this system of geopolitical policy. Because if we act without saying that, all we're doing is playing into the flames of World War III.
Yes, sir.
Yes, my name is Lawrence Kavanaugh from Hollywood, Florida. Congratulations for being out of prison. I hope the exoneration comes next. I say this, if they can exonerate Ollie North, which I don't know if they actually did that or not, then I don't know if you would have a chance of getting in. So anyway, Mr. LaRouche, I've been reading EIR and your literature's and writings for about 3 years now, and I've received an education that is unavailable in the free world. Of course, that's a misnomer. It's certainly unavailable in the United States, but it's not a misnomer to say that this is an unfree world, an unfree country. As you said, we are vassals of the British for a long time. But my question is this. Baranowski threatened the use of the Epsilon bomb that could wipe out humanity. Now, I know this probably goes back to Nikola Tesla, who was chased out of this country, went to Yugoslavia, and the communists took over his science, I believe, at that time. And a Colonel Breeden, a former military intelligence man, has talked about this as well. And he says the only reason the Russians haven't used it to wipe out everyone is because there are two other countries that would retaliate, and he wouldn't give the names of those countries on the tape, on the audio that I have. But he said he would divulge that if you wrote to him. He's associated with the Tesla Institute. Do you have anything to say about that possibility of that weapon existing?
I wouldn't look in that direction. I would say that when we're talking about weapon systems, what I know is from what I've known from years past, the general background. As you recall, I said that there are these new, what's called new physical principles, which is really just the frontier of physics is all it is. And if we were going to develop effective systems against a strategic launch of thermonuclear attack, missile attack, we would have to use this to be effective. There are many things. There are, in this field of linear, nonlinear electromagnetic spectrum, there are many things that can be done. There's a whole range of weapons. I do not know what Mr. Zhirinovsky was talking about. I can only indicate that the area in which he pointed, there is a lot of actuality and potentiality there. I don't think one has to speculate on Tesla to do that. The danger is that instead of using these technologies for as we should be using them, the only place we have this kind of thing is in the military area, in most countries where it exists. I wouldn't say that the only reason they're not used is because of fear of retaliation, no. There is not, at this moment, a casus belli. We are not yet at the point of war. If we continue the kind of policy we're tolerating the British and others carrying out in various parts of the world, we will be in a casus belli. The point is, don't worry about weapons. I don't worry about weapons. Guns don't kill people. Guns just sit there. Axes don't kill people. Axes just sit there. People kill people. And they use axes or guns or whatever is available. And when people start to kill each other or fight each other in large numbers, they will use the best weapons they have available. If they know how to use them, they can get them. The thing to worry about is the adversarial relationship and the development of adversarial relationships in the sense of driving the world to wars which are unjustified. If you drive the world to an unjustified war, you are going to get from major powers, which have major scientific capabilities, you're going to get weapons of a type you have not seen before in public print. Of that I can assure you. The trick is, don't worry about the weapons. I don't worry about the weapons technology. Some people do. Worry about the policy which drives nations into the point that they're going to go to war. Because once they're going to go to war, serious nations are going to use the best weapons they have.
I would just like to say at this point, we are going to stop at 3:15. And the way we've structured the remaining panels and the questions and answer period is we're going to have, after this question period, just the presentations, and we're going to bunch all of the questions and answers into two full panels tomorrow of questions and answers. So that way we can maximize the discussion process have many, many hours of questions and answers. So let's continue this. I just want to say one brief thing. I would like to welcome here Dr. Ali Mohammed from Washington, D.C. He is here in the audience. It's a pleasure having him here. Next question.
My name is Mark Walker. I'm from Tidewater, Virginia. This is directed to either Lyndon or Helga LaRouche. When I talk to conservatives about the physical economy, there is a reflexive action against it, as if there's a big wall there, as if it's inflationary, socialist, Marxist, whatever that's there. What is your experience in breaking this reflex?
Well, first of all, when you talk about a conservative, you have to understand why I sometimes say that the synonym for neoconservative is rubber marmalade. Because most of these fellows that I know of who are the so-called neoconservatives were at one time either followers of Bukharin or Trotsky. And somehow, because the bankers who financed them told them to move in a different direction, they are now called right-wingers. But if you... their version, when they were Marxists, and I knew some of them when they were Marxists, I debated them, they had the afflictions of which I spoke. They didn't, all they understood is what Marx learned from the British school of Haileybury. Remember, as you'll find out, Marx was, well, anyway, that'd take too long to answer. But in any case, they are that. Now, they are... Conservative does not mean that somehow they're not eccentric. As a matter of fact, they believe in economics 101. And many times I've tried to educate them, but generally I will look for a priest who'll perform a different kind of operation on them, which will get the demon out of them. Now, the one thing you have to realize about these people is they're not serious. Most of these neoconservatives have mouths which they rent. They have taximeters somewhere behind their ear. They rent their mouths. They work for financial interests. They dream of sitting at a personal computer and making $1 million speculating on derivatives or options without working for it. They walk around and pretend to be very important people who know all about high finance. And if you get them in a corner and talk to them, they're really very stupid. And that's the problem. And I wouldn't treat them seriously. Some of them are salvageable, but they would have to go through an exorcism, I believe, to reach that quality.
Yes. Yes.
My name is Sharti Hilliard. I'm from Atlanta, Georgia. And I wanted to make a comment and then ask a question. My comment is that during the course of this morning and I guess part of this afternoon, and in some of the talks that, at least the talk that Mr. LaRouche presented, I noticed that most of the people that he referred to in the educational process that would help develop us as a people and help move us along on the path that we need to be were of you, or most of them were of European descent. And I think that that kind of brings about an imbalance of what the truth is and what we need to be looking at in order to really educate our people to present their best foot forward for the future. Not only that, my question is this organization as well fighting for reparations for those atrocities done to African people since we've been in this country? In addition to that, I think that in order for us to reach out to help anyone outside of our immediate environment, we first have to learn how to treat each other. And I want to know what is going to be done about what has happened to the people of this country, the natives, and those people that were brought here to build this country. And when are we going to, when will this organization take a stand on that issue and represent what is, as Reverend Bevel said, constitutional righteousness right here at home? Anybody can answer that question.
The history of human achievement prior to, say, 4,000, 6,000 BC, or in that range, includes the discovery or the precursors of science in such forms chiefly as the development of astronomy, solar, sidereal calendars of 26,000 year and longer cycles. That was an achievement which occurs in China, it occurs in Central Asia, to our knowledge. It occurred in pre-pyramids Egypt. Otherwise, they wouldn't have had a pyramid. They didn't make the discovery first. However, the development of science, the development of the crucial features of modern culture, although they had a great debt to many sources in humanity before them, China, Central Asia, India, Egypt, and so forth, that the development of science in Europe during the 15th, 16th, 17th century, into the 18th century in particular, is a phenomenon which is not replicated yet in any part of the world in human history. Now, so therefore the child who is being educated must be given the knowledge which has been given from wherever it comes. I take the view that whatever is created which is valuable belongs to everyone. As to far as to the people who suffered slavery in this country and Jim Crow, in some ways 60 years or 65 years of Jim Crow left scars as deep as slavery, particularly if you remember that slavery ended in this country in 1865 and Jim Crow was officially established in 1901. So that gives you about 36 years of non-slavery, which is just a little over a generation. And then people were put back in the name of not being slaves to being slaves for 65 years, essentially, before officially we ended the form of slavery called Jim Crow. The problem is some people today, young people, forget that because they didn't live through that. The civil rights movement made a change, which is not to be forgotten. The way to deal with the suffering of the people who were slaves What can you do for them? They have died. The people who were slaves in many generations before 1865, the people who were the survivors of those who were dragged out of Africa by Genoese, British, and Dutch slave traders, including the slave trading family of DeLeon that founded the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry in the United States and that founded B'nai B'rith in 1843 for the British Intelligence Service. What can you do for justice for those who have died? For those who died because they didn't make it to the boats? For the men who died because they killed them because they wouldn't make good transportable slaves in the world? For those who died on the boats and never made it? For those who suffered, what can you do? You can tell their story and talk about their descendants. You can be infused with a sense of justice undone. And you can say, what can you do for them? You can take the children of their descendants and you can educate them to the best, and you can give them opportunities for the best, and you can create a country in which they have justice and participate in it. And then they can look back in their imagination to their departed ancestors and say, you suffered, but your suffering was not in vain, for we have arrived at the land of justice, and your journey was not in vain.
I want to speak to this question in relationship to when people meet, what lie and be on the floor. You got to always say, well, we discussing truth or we discussing a lie. Now, go back to constitutionality. When I meet a human being, the question, there's a thing called greeting, to speak to people. It's good morning. What are you really saying is, what is our collective, common, constitutional interest and responsibility, and how do we exercise the authority thereof? That's a greeting. Our constitution and law, and theological law, does not give credence to the assumption of race. The assumption of race is a language created by criminals who breed slaves, horses, whores and hounds. They come up with this race theory. So when you come from God's law and you come from constitutional law, there is no assumption of race. Now, let me tell you what this assumption of race keeps us from addressing the constitutional interest. The question is, how then do we educate our young people, boys and girls, so that they are institutionally sovereign and economically independent? Because it's an assumption that under slavery, the blacks suffer more than the white. It's not true. I had to learn this in terms of, when I was in a marital situation. I'd be hurting and I thought my wife was happy. When communication breaks down, the internal suffering is as great in both persons. You see? So when slavery exists, you have two sick psychologies. You got an arrogant man in a relationship with a coward man. You got to psychoanalytically solve the problem of the cowardliness and the arrogance, because both men are ill. So the question becomes, who owe who? Don't nobody owe anybody anything. The question is, how do you correct the problem? You see, if you start from an assumption that someone oppressed someone, you will never solve the problem of oppression. You must understand that oppression of a person and a people is the result of not having integrity. Please understand that. And I'll, you know, whoever needs to work with me further on this, I will explain that to you in scientific details. That it is impossible for a human being to do what God told him to do and be oppressed. That is not even possible. That is the biggest lie we have to get out of our heads and out of our language and out of this culture.
that the law says you reap what you sow. That's not just a flim-flam statement. That's a reality science. Because we don't want to go deep enough to really know that, you see? Because when you get in terms of an oppressed relationship between, say, groups like blacks and whites, when you go back and study what is going on in the internal relationship between the black man and the black woman, or the white man and the white woman, you have both of them participating in oppressive internal marital relationships. So you can understand that. You can say, okay, we got a sociological oppressive state. Well, where does it come from psychologically, and where does it come from in terms of interpersonal relationships? And so when you get into the disease state between the black male and the black female, or the white male and the white female, the disease state is the same. So if you come on that from a science point of view, you got to correct both of those problems. Now, let me just say one other thing on that for the sister here. Lynn said today that there is no math to describe this creative process, and it doesn't exist. There is something that does, which is called integrity. What integrity gives a person is the ability to correctly analyze history. It also gives them the ability to correctly and truthfully interpret society as it is happening, and it gives them the ability to create scientific plans for the future. All right. So who can decide the outcome in the future? Those who have integrity. Now, it has nothing to do with race, because there's no such thing. The man, male or female, who develops integrity can correct the problem. And this is how Paul wrote it. He says, and when the perfect is come, the imperfect will pass away. Now, so what are we calling you to be? We don't play about it. We are calling you to be perfect people. Y'all think that's too much? Because as long as there are crooked people, there are going to be crooked systems. So if you want a straight system, you got to have what? Straight people. Now, you may think that's too much to ask of you, but we'll get into workshops later on. We'll show you how that's done. So where we are now is, no, don't nobody owe me anything. I owe people. If God created me in his image and likeness, and I don't assume that responsibility, then nobody stop me from doing that. Our job is to awaken the peoples of the world to this fact. And when we get this lie off the floor, people will stop arming and shooting at each other. That you are the source of your own oppression. Please understand that. And I know that men, black folks fight about this all the time, Lynn. And this is what I fought about in Birmingham. And when I got the young people to understand that, they was able to change the situation. And when we get them to understand that now, they in fact become the leaders. Because when you go through the process of confessing and repenting and correcting and forgiving and making a motion in the interest of the whole, you will always see in that equation the contribution you made to your own oppression and the contribution the other person made to his own oppression. In other words, white folks have oppressed white people. White people are slaves. Why do you think Clinton Gump said, well, your boys can now be girls? No schools. I mean, white folks are slaves. They're in trouble. So don't assume that the guy who has a privilege is free. A man with a privilege is a slave. You're free in terms of when you know how to scientifically exercise your rights. And the white people don't know how to do that. They do not have an equity. They don't have an economic system that Lynn is talking about, which has nothing to do with white people. It has to do with a level of intelligence. And I have to say this before I sit, because this question come up. Why do you subscribe to what they call white science? Ain't no such thing as white science. Ain't no such thing as white chemistry. Ain't no such thing. I mean, aviation and aeronautics is aviation and aeronautics. That's period. Now, if you want to fly, you can't go study white flying and black flying. You just have to study aviation and aeronautics. Now, it would be well for those who have not resolved the problem of the inferiority complex to understand, and you can go back and study history. And I think one of the great contributions that Lynn has made to theology, and it'll come out in the future, is that there's a strand of history that's missing from our theological, historical understanding. All of the sciences that came out in Europe, if you go back and study Nicholas of Cusa and all these guys were Christians. And I don't mean in the shout and going to church foolishness game. I mean, they thought Christian theology. That's why that development took place in Europe. And let me say to you this. When we put in precinct councils and get all of the people to start thinking through church work and government work and business work and clinic work and home work and school work as a lifestyle, you will see that it has nothing to do with race. That the American people, black and white and Indians, when we put the precinct councils in, we will set off an industrial scientific revolution and renaissance unprecedented in the history of man. But not because somebody gives somebody some meat from last year. No, what we can create now. So our job is to release the creativity of the American mind and the children's mind by fighting for an economic and educational policy. If you get into this game about pay us back, the hustlers are going to beat you in that game. Yeah. Let's talk about what happened under Johnson's OEO policy. Who got the money? The hustlers. But when you get into correcting the problem, making sure that all children are educated so they can produce and run institutions, now you're protecting the educational rights and the economic development rights of all of the children and all of the people, and out of that they create wealth untold. So when he gets into this thing about there's no limits to growth, so don't fight for that. Fight for real freedom. And then we'll liberate all of the people and we'll have a whole new world. And please believe that there is no such thing as race. That the Constitution doesn't cover it and God doesn't cover it.